Mentioned that I had been at the bishop's convocation this week. That's a gathering, not convocation, excuse me. I think I said convocation, that's the wrong word. The bishop's Eucharist. Our bishop likes to gather the pastors from each conference. Our synod's divided up into conferences. This is the Rainier Conference, aptly enough, that extends from us, includes Yelm, goes all the way up into Tacoma and over towards Edgewood. And the church is all in between. So the Puyallup and Spanaway churches are all included here. He likes to gather us together and have the Eucharist together. He gets to preach and then kind of update us on what's going on in the synod, give us some ideas from the larger church, things he's learned. And otherwise, it's just good fellowship. And the text he selected for his message was the upcoming gospel, the one we just read. And he talked about how we're all waiting for something, how the Jews are waiting for the Messiah. And not very often do I disagree with my bishop, but on that occasion I thought to myself, well, were they really waiting for the Messiah? Let me qualify that. Because he went on to say that each of us is waiting in our own way for something in our lives, for our lives to be changed somehow, for transformation, for better conditions, for something in our life to be better. Okay, I can work on that, and I can see maybe the people in Jesus' day hoping for change, for transformation, for to get those Romans out of Jerusalem, or whatever they may be desiring. But were they really expecting a Messiah? Some probably were. There were probably some zealous factions who were really regularly looking for the Messiah. But I imagine the vast majority of folks went about their daily lives. The regular rituals of the faith reminded them of Messiah. But beyond that, were they really actively looking and hoping and searching? We here have John the Baptist shows up and causes some confusion. And when you consider that those who went out, sent the priests and the Levites, those who went out to meet him, may have been the folks who were really looking for a Messiah, you can understand their confusion when he said, "I am not the Messiah." Well, then who are you? Are you Elijah? We're kind of hoping for him to show up. That would be nice. If we can't have the Messiah, maybe Elijah will do. Are you Elijah? Nope. Well, then who are you? Are you a prophet? If you are, which one? You know, they're pulling out their who's who of prophets and checking to see which one he fits with. None of those. Nope. Then who are you? And then we hear the words that we heard last week. Gotta love it. Same thing 2 weeks in a row. Well, I'm the voice of one crying out in the wilderness. Oh, he's Isaiah. I think that's Isaiah. Isn't that Isaiah? Look that up. Yeah, that's Isaiah. He's Isaiah. That's who he is. Wait a minute. We weren't expecting Isaiah. No one's expecting Isaiah. Elijah, yes. Well, okay, maybe he is a prophet, but he's baptizing. Did Elijah do that? Well, he sent that one guy to the river. Now, wait a minute. Was that Elijah? No, that was Elijah. Now, wait a minute. Did Isaiah baptize? What's he doing baptizing? Can you understand their confusion? He doesn't fit any of their categories. He doesn't match up with anything that they were expecting. And I imagine the vast majority of people coming to see John were not expecting him to even be a Messiah. These folks were, and they were confused. John said, "Well, I baptize with water. Among you stands one you don't know. The one who's coming after me." Again, similar words that we heard last week. Only here we don't get the "I'll baptize you with water, he'll baptize you with the Spirit." We just get the "I'm not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal." My wife says it's okay that I make this joke. Dyslexics of the world, untie. I'm not worthy to untie the thong of his sandal. Well, okay then. If you're not worthy to untie his sandal, maybe he's Messiah. Maybe he should be the one we're looking for. Of course, then when he shows up and claims to be Messiah, they're ready to crucify him. That doesn't work out very well. So what about the rest of us? Are you expecting a Messiah? Are you hoping for a Savior? Are you waiting for someone to show up and change things? I don't think we want a Messiah. I don't think we want a Savior. I think more often than not, we want the status quo. We like things just to be the way they are. Until things don't quite work right, and then we need someone to fix it. When do you visit the aisle of the hardware store that you've never visited before? When do you go to that place in the hardware store that you have no idea what all these little parts and all these little bins are? When it's time to repair something, that's when. I tell you what, I've learned more about how things work because they break. When I was in high school, I took high school electronics, which, yeah, I learned Ohm's law, I learned some electrical theory, I learned how capacitors work and so on. Got that basic stuff, but mostly it was VCR repair class. Anytime the school had a VCR that was broken, they would send it to the electronics class. Well, let's let them work on it. Hey, they're doing electronics, a VCR's electronics, send it to them. Most of the time it was a belt. I kept a ready supply of belts. I could take the case off of the VCR, I could find the loose belt, I could look in our box of belts, I could put a new belt on. Had the right tension in it, I could put the case back on, we'd stick a tape in, sure enough, everything was fine. Most of the time. Was that electronics? Kinda. It's repair work. We don't often want to fix things, well, until we need to. Things are going fine, why do you need fixing? If you're not in need of salvation, why do you need a Savior? I imagine most people hearing John's message didn't need a Savior. Some nut down at the river baptizing people. Well, I've already been baptized. Why do we need that? Well, then don't go see him. It sounds really simple, doesn't it? If you're not sick, do you just go to the doctor for fun? No. But you're supposed to go for regular checkups. Now we're edging towards our need. You're supposed to go for regular checkups. When do you go to the dentist? How many of you go twice a year? That's at least when your dentist wants you to go. I remember growing up, he only went once a year. And then suddenly it became twice a year, and I thought, it must be inflation. You're supposed to go regularly to the dentist. We go regularly to the doctor for our checkups. Because those regular checkups can sometimes prevent larger, more painful conditions from becoming a fact of life in our bodies. You need to watch that tooth down there in the front. Let me give you a prescription for some good toothpaste. I never grew up with prescriptions for toothpaste either, but I guess the world changes, yeah? And you really want to brush that and keep your eye on it. What he's really saying is, next time we're going to drill and fill that sucker. Huh? No, I recently read something that the dentist probably doesn't want to hear, that substantial doses of regular vitamin C actually prevent more cavities than brushing. But that's a whole other topic altogether. But you really need to go regularly and get your health looked at. Makes good sense. But we don't often think of it, do we? No. Until you get a chip on a tooth, until you get a little pain on one side, those things cause us maybe to think, I better go. Oh, what is that strange feeling? I'm not sure what that is. I'm not going to worry about it. No, there it is again. You better go get it checked out. When the need arises, of course we go. But the regular stuff is harder to do. And then there's the weekly stuff. That's regular maintenance. Let's go back to our mechanical idea again. And if you don't go down that aisle of the hardware store until you need the part because it's broken, what sort of regular maintenance do you do? One of the least maintained things in our home has to be the common household blender. Do you know there's a maintenance schedule for blenders? When you go home, flip your blender over and look, there's a little tag on the bottom. As places where you're supposed to regularly... Okay, at this point I'm pulling your leg completely. I apologize. But seriously, there are items in your home that you do maintain, yes? Do you scrub your shower? I hope. You keep your toilet clean. There's not just sanitary issues, but there's maintenance issues. How many of you periodically run a dishwasher load of vinegar? A few of you do that. I see some heads nodding. See, so there are some preventative maintenance things you can do on the mechanical stuff as well. What reminds you to do that? Something you just think of? Sometimes it's just something that comes to mind. I need to do that. It's about time we do that. Spring cleaning. We get in the habit of doing certain ritual cleanings every spring. Or maybe fall raking if we have a lot of leaves. Or getting the moss off the roof a certain time of year. I mean, they're regular maintenance things we do, too. You get the point. I don't want to belabor it too much. What about our faith? How many of us tend to our faith on a regular way? Well, you're here. You're tending to your faith in a regular way. You're doing it. Of course. Yeah, duh. But how many of us go beyond that? I want to challenge us to grow and go beyond just the weekly worship. I mean, yeah, if you got that one, you can get an indelible marker and mark that off of, you know, check that off of your, okay, worship weekly, got that. Good. Now pick one of the other six, the other five that are remaining, and work on that one, on our marks of discipleship. We do that kind of spiritual maintenance, don't we? There are lots of ways to do spiritual maintenance. Regular Bible study, devotion, prayer, being involved in fellowship groups with others, mission work, service work, and so on. Of course. In those moments, we really meet the Savior. We find God in service. We find the Savior in prayer. You go into regular prayer, God is going to meet up with you eventually. All those who call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. All those who seek shall find. The Scripture is full of that kind of promise. But what about folks who don't come to God unless the need is dire? Right after that in John, we get folks coming out to be baptized by John. And what kind of folks are they? Folks for whom we would say the need is obvious. The sinners, the tax collectors, the prostitutes. Those are the ones who are listed there. They come out to be baptized. Well, of course, their need of God is obvious. They have a pain in the tooth. Their dishwasher's making a rattly noise. They know it's time to fix something. Their life isn't working the way it ought to work. Those who are confused, these are the priests and Levites from the Jews. Who are you? What are you doing here? Why are you baptizing? I don't get it. Our life is fine. We go to temple. We have our regular baptism. We go bathe in the pool. We get clean. We make our sacrifices. Everything's working out fine. John says, I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness. Make straight the way of the Lord. Let me ask you this question. How many of you have ever faced a repair that was too big for you to handle? Most of us, right? I remember my Volvo. The first car I drove was a 1970 Volvo. And my parents were the original owner. And they hung on to it. And in 1990, when I started driving it, just to, you know, I'm sorry if it makes you feel old. I apologize now. 1990, when I started driving that car, in Florida, and when it was 20 years old, it could be considered a classic at that point. Wow. I don't think no one would look at it and call it classic. Not even Volvo lovers would love that sort of turkey turd yellow it was. I'm sorry, was that allowed? It was this mustard yellow color. Baby poo comes to mind. It's just really not a very attractive color. But it had a stick shift, four on the floor, and when you're driving on the road, that stick was like this because it was that long. But the thing was, you could open up the hood, and I don't know much about auto mechanics, but I could work on this car. You could open the hood, you could look past the motor and see the ground underneath the car. Now, I wouldn't know where to start. I can check the oil in my Toyota, but I'm glad that dashboard has lights to remind me of those sort of things. Things get complicated. And who do you go to when the problem is too big to solve? Someone who knows. Whether it's a car, or whether it's a tooth, whether it's a dishwasher, when the problem's too big, you go to someone else. Maybe it's the scope of the problem. Maybe it's such a huge undertaking to think that I couldn't do all this by myself. You're glad to have someone by your side to work with you, come alongside you and help you get it done. Even if it's work you can manage, just having that someone with you, knowing that they're there, can make all the difference. So too, when we're up a spiritual creek, a lot of times folks come to a pastor, folks will go to a counselor, folks will go to a trusted friend. Who do you go to when you're facing a spiritual struggle that feels too big to handle? Yeah, if it's regular maintenance, we are generally pretty good at that. You can set an alarm. There's all kinds of tricks that we can use to remind ourselves to do the regular maintenance of the spiritual life, the daily prayer, the scripture study, and the weekly worship, and so on. And yes, when there's an acute need that we feel like we can handle, well, we can really devote ourselves to prayer. We can crack open a Bible, and the Word of God can speak to us. The Holy Spirit will jump off the page, and the answer may be right there. Or maybe it's a conversation with a friend. Reminds us that, guess what? Nothing's going to separate you from the love of God. You are God's. You belong to God. God loves you, and there ain't nothing you can do about it, so deal with it. Maybe that's all it takes. But when the problem's overwhelming, when the doctor sits you down and utters that C word, you get hit with that knock at the door, and the man in uniform, when the police officer comes to the door late at night, you fill in the blank. Think about those problems that whap us, the whammies that get us, that are just overwhelming. Who comes alongside us then? Now let's flip it over. Have you ever been the person who has come alongside someone who has been in over their heads? Have you been the person who's been the one helping? See, I'm going to say this, and you know it's already true. The world takes both kinds. Those who are hurting and those who are not. Sometime in our lives, all of us are the ones who are in need of help when our acute need is so strong. And other times, we are the ones who are able to help. We are the helpers. But all of us, whether we are the ones who are receiving help or we are the ones providing help, all of us are in need of a Messiah. All of us need a Savior. Of course, the need is obvious when we are the ones who are hurting. Hosanna in the highest. Save us. That's what Hosanna means. We cry out to God, help, I'm drowning. This is too big for me. We cry out to our friends, come, help me, save me. But do we know our need of God when we are the ones helping? Sometimes that's obvious too. A friend comes to you and says, can I talk to you about something? Sure, what is it? And they land something on your lap that you feel really ill-equipped to deal with. You may not be able to fix that washing machine or work on that car, but recently I was asked to give someone some assistance. Provided the help, but part of the work was dealing with someone on the phone. And the word work involved was the technical work of waiting for the person on the phone who was thousands of miles away to tap on their keyboard and get their computer to do the right thing. Tech support, you know what I'm talking about? I will tell you, maybe this is too candid, but I would almost rather sit at the bedside of a dying person than deal with tech support. Sometimes it's that frustrating, yes? Oh, I get problems that come across my desk that I think, I'm going to need to get back to you on that. I can listen and help you now in my limited way, but this is too big for me. And it's in those times, especially those times, that I'm reminded that all of us who are well, those who are called on to help the sick, those who are called on to help those who are feeling helpless, we all need the help of the Lord. We all need the straight path through the wilderness. We all need the Savior. Messiah. It's easy to remember that need when we're the ones who are hurting. Sometimes we think we've got it figured out. Sometimes we think, I'm good at this. I've been doing this for how many odd years? Realized I've just been, I've only been ordained. In June, it'll be 12 years. It's not that long in the grand scheme of things, especially after having lunch with a pastor who's been doing this for 45 years, still going strong. Thinking, well, puts things in perspective to be around others who've been doing it much longer than you have. All of those men and women in that room, all of us here, whether we are sick or well, we need the voice of the one crying in the wilderness. We need to hear the call. Seek the Messiah. Seek him when you are well. Seek him when you are sick. Seek him in the morning. Seek him in the noontime. Seek God no matter what. This is your reminder from me. This is our reminder for us all. Jesus came we would have the Spirit's help, God's help, in time of need, in time of want, and all the rest of the time as well.